Are you on a journey? Are you looking for real people who understand real needs, offering real help? Then join us for a genuine experience with a real God. Welcome to Journey Church. At Journey Church, we offer real life help for real life needs. Join us now for a time of amazing hope and practical help from the Bible. Join us at Journey Church.
One of the things that I just sat up under my garage all week long and prayed, read my Bible, trying to figure out, Lord, what do you want me to speak on? What would you like for me to share? And, you know, the pieces begin coming in of people coming by my house and saying, you know, well, God did this and God did that, and this is because God's mad, and I'm hearing all these misconceptions of God. And then I'm seeing other people walking in pure fear and torment. You know, before this hurricane ever got here, they had Myrtle Beach worked up in a frenzy. I mean, man, it was, people were bailing out of town a week before it arrived. And honestly, this was just category one. I lived through Hugo. It was a whole lot bigger than that. Yes, this had more water, but you know, a storm is a storm. And I'm not trying to belittle. I'm just saying that it seems like fear. And isn't it funny, before this storm, we were in a series on fear, and we're still in that series of fear today, but this message is entitled, In God We Trust. One thing that I've noticed is we struggle trusting God when things in our world look bigger than God. Jeremiah 29:11, we're given this promise. Now, I want you to understand, all throughout the Bible, we're given scripture that shows us God's character. Let's look at it. This is God speaking. For I know the thoughts that I think toward you, saith the Lord. Somebody say, I'm here. What is God thinking toward me? I know what I'm thinking toward me. I know what I deserve. I know what I've done. I know what goes on in my mind. I know what I did in my past. I know the things I've done that weren't upright, the things that I've done that didn't have any integrity. I know the perfect life that I've not lived. Does anybody know their own perfect life, or do you live in denial? I mean, you know, because a lot of people live on that river, denial. For I know, some of you just caught that. For I know the thoughts. Some of you have a river house on. I'm just kidding. I won't go. For I know the thoughts I think toward you, saith the Lord. Thoughts of how bad you are. Thoughts of what I'm going to do to you because of what you've done to me. That's the way we live. But what did God say? The thoughts I have toward you are thoughts of peace. Repeat after me. God wants me to live and walk in peace. So why am I not? I'm not because I don't trust Him. My problem is bigger than my God. There's no way around it. You see, God's word is either yes and amen, or it's no. And in God's word, He says, I want you to live in peace. I've given you everything you need, Colossians 2:10 says. Everything I need to do what? To live in peace. He's given me everything that I need. Why am I not living in peace? Because I've taken something that I've seen or I've heard, or that the enemy has whispered into my ear, and I've made it bigger than what God has promised. Can anybody say amen to that? Amen. He says, I have thoughts of you, thoughts of peace and not of evil, to give you an expected end. He says He wants you to be prosperous. He wants you to flourish and to grow, which means you have to have roots. If you learned anything about trees during this storm, the thing that you learn is that a pine tree has a tap root. It goes straight down, then spreads up. An oak tree goes out and then down. And you learn real quick that oak trees will peel up and fall down. Pine trees will snap off. Sometimes a root comes up if they hit really hard clay that they can't get through, and their tap root's not real deep. But the one thing you learn is when a storm comes, you discover the weakness of the tree. But the bigger and the deeper the root system, the more firmly anchored that tree is, yes? Well, the same thing goes for people. During storms, you discover your weaknesses. What did you discover about yourself during the storm? Well, when the river came up behind my house and was from here to the camera from my back door, I opened all the windows and slid the chairs where we could see it while we watched TV. And Terry looked at me. My shop is flooded, you know. I've already moved everything out of it. And we've moved everything up from the edge of the woods. And I'm still looking at Terry and I'm smiling. And she said, "What do you smile about?" I said, "I have always wanted a riverfront property here at the beach." The kids, Gabby and Mary Hannah and Andrew, went out and filmed videos. And Gabby and Mary Hannah got in a raft and they paddled up and down the backyard in the water. And we just had fun. "Pastor, you weren't worried about it coming into your house?" Well, if it would have, what difference would it have made? What, I lost carpet? I lost some furniture? I still got my kids, still got my family. I mean, what, it would have torn up my house? I don't like the house anyway. I mean, come on, we worry about what compared to God's promise that it is God's plan. Now tell me, if God's plan is for us to have peace and for us to prosper, why are we worried about the enemy trying to take away our peace and take away our prosperity? Do we think that Satan is bigger than God? No. The disciples thought that Satan was bigger than God because of the storm that they were in. Man, Jesus was sleeping in the boat and they were upstairs bailing water, flipping out and panicking. When they called Jesus up, he looked at the storm and said, "Shh." And it calmed down. He was at peace. He didn't fret a bit. What did he know? That the words of his Father are yes and amen. And if God has said it, then it is. Psalms 56 and 3 says this: "When I'm afraid, I need to trust you." Say it with me. When I'm afraid, I need to trust him. It's difficult, isn't it? Somebody, is it difficult? Is it? Because if it was easy, everybody'd be doing it. Especially Christians. Christians don't ever panic. Do we? Christians don't ever have knee-jerk responses to the economy or politics or things we read in the newspaper. How many of you know that good news doesn't sell newspapers? Let me see your hands. So you read it expecting what? To be encouraged? You watch news expecting to be uplifted and encouraged, right? Okay. So tell me something. Of all the years you've been watching the news, has it changed? People still getting killed? Drowned? Shot? Abusing one another? Stealing? Robbing? So you're watching reruns every time you turn it on. I'm just calling out the obvious. Proverbs 3, 5, and 6 tells me this. Trust in the Lord when it's convenient. Oh, I'm sorry, wrong version. Trust in the Lord when it's easy. And only trust the Lord when you can understand what He's doing. No? Oh, I'm sorry. Let's look at it the way it's supposed to be read. Trust in the Lord with all of your heart. The heart, the soul, is where you think, feel, and choose. So I trust in the Lord with all I think, all I feel, and all I choose. And don't lean on my own understanding. Why? Because I don't understand everything. And in all your ways, look to Him. Not WMBF, not the weather, not the clouds, not the finances. Look to Him. And what will He do? Fix it? No. He'll show you what to do next. Listen to me. Here's an interesting thought. I haven't fully developed this yet, but it's an interesting thought. Everything you do in Christianity is a cooperation. It's not an enablement or an entitlement. God doesn't do for you. God assists you in your doing. You need to grab that. Here's what I discovered in the Bible this week, some of my reading in it. It kind of threw me for a loop. And I haven't developed it fully. Okay? But I read in one gospel where Jesus tells me that He's interceding for me. You agree with that? I read in another gospel in Romans where I'm told that the Holy Spirit intercedes for me. I'm never told God intercedes for me. But hang on. If the Holy Spirit's praying for me, Jesus is praying for me, could it be that I'm supposed to be the third part of that union praying together? And am I supposed to be in agreement with them? So that those three strands of a cord are not easily broken? Am I supposed to be in agreement? Then what are they praying? And am I praying in opposition to them? Or am I praying in agreement with them? And if I'm praying in agreement with them, I can guarantee you I know what they're praying. They're praying what this says. They're praying what God has promised us. They're praying what's in the will. The benefits of the will is what they're praying. Because that's what God promised is mine. Amen. You with me so far? Let's take a look at this. How about Romans 15 and 13? And we're going to read this from the NIV. May the God of hope, the God of what? When are they going to name a hurricane Hope? May the God of hope fill you with all dread and worry. I'm sorry. I keep reverting to what I see instead of what I know. May the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace as you trust in Him. So if I'm going to be filled with joy, and if I'm going to be filled with peace, I've got to put my trust not in man, not in money, not in meteorologists, not in politics, not in the government, not in religion, but in God. He cannot fail. And if I do, look what he says. I will barely have enough and get by. I will overflow with hope by the power of the Holy Spirit. Anybody want to overflow in the middle of a storm? Great God. If anybody had to learn, Job had to learn. But let me show you what fear does. This was in the newspaper this morning. WMBF News, Lumberton, North Carolina. Headlines. Isn't that something? Don't you love telephones? Don't you love? I pull that aggravating thing up. Give me just a second. Here it is. Okay, you got the picture up there for me? Pull up the picture of the news article. There you go. This was WMBF, Lumberton, North Carolina. For the first time since river levels became so high in the Lumberton area, people are able to get through water and in their flooded home and into their flooded homes to check on them. One mother said they got out of there Saturday in the middle of the night as soon as they could tell water levels were rising and rising quickly. She got a ride to take her and her four kids to Charlotte to stay with family until she couldn't wait any longer to see what her home looks like now. "Oh my gosh," she says, "the first feeling, I was just nervous in the stomach. If anybody has ever felt this in fear, then when I read this line, I'm going to pause. I want you to say amen. You ready? Oh my gosh, the first feeling, I was just nervous in the stomach. Amen. I've been throwing up for the last few days. I can't keep food down. Just traumatized because we've never experienced anything like this. So my children, they're going through it, but we're pulling together." She said, "For 6 days, the feeling of the unknown has haunted her. My son just kept saying, 'Mom, I don't want to die. I don't want to die.' Noting the feeling of chaos and not knowing where help was coming from." Fear. Fear. Fear is the first emotion that man felt in the garden after he fell. Before that, he felt peace. Before that, man was at peace. He walked at peace with God. But after the fall, they were afraid of God. And unfortunately, in the church today, we're propagating and we're still afraid of God. Afraid of the God that sought them out. Afraid of the God that covered their sin. Afraid of the God that forgave them. Afraid of the God that protected them. Why are we afraid of a God who does nothing but love his people? Let me show you something. I'm going to go to the most misunderstood book in the Bible. Let's go to Job for a moment. And I'm going to try to rectify some stupid. I don't know of any other way to say it. In the book of Job, everybody reads Job and thinks that Job, that the word perfect means Job had no flaws, when the book of Job points out Job's flaws. Repeat after me. I reap what I sow. But in grace and in God's love, I never reap the full benefit of what I've sown. I reap enough to learn. You see, God's a good father. God doesn't do bad things to his kids. Oh, but Pastor, the Bible says God's wrathful. Yes, the word wrath means God lifts his hand. I'm going to show you that in the book of Job. But the reason God lifted his hand was because this was the desire or the strongest emotion in Job's heart. Let me show you something. Job 1:1. "There was a man in the land of Uz whose name was Job, and he was perfect and upright, and one that feared God and eschewed evil." The word perfect here means mature, complete, entire. A man who was wanting for nothing. It doesn't mean a man who lives spotlessly. Okay? Because you come right on down to verse 5. And it says, "And it was so when the days of their feasting were gone about, Job sent and sanctified them," talking about his seven sons and his three daughters. Okay? "Job sent and sanctified them, and he rose up early in the morning and offered burnt offerings according to the number of them all. For Job said, 'It may be that my sons have sinned and God and cursed God in their hearts.' Thus Job did how often?" Can you say fear? Job walked in fear because he knew his kids didn't love God like he did. So he was constantly offering up offerings for his kids because Job believed that God was angry. How many of you know Job was wrong? If you don't, you hadn't read the end of Job yet, right? Because until you get to the end of Job, there ain't no sense in reading the first part of Job. Now, verses 6 through 6 and 7, we see a conversation where Satan appears in heaven before God because he's commanded to appear before the boss. How many of you know that Satan's not God's enemy, God doesn't have any enemies because nobody is greater than or equal to God. Therefore, he has no enemies. He stands alone. 8, the Lord said to Satan, have you considered my servant Job? Word considered here. Interesting word. The word considered here means in the Hebrew, have you looked at the emotions in his heart? Here's what's funny too. What Job's name means. In some Hebrew tongue, in the most recent Hebrew translation and tongue, his name means one accursed or one who is pressed by evil. But in the old Hebrew, we're talking Hebrew before 1948 when they had to relearn Hebrew again. The word Job means in its original, where is my father? You see, the book of Job is a man's journey of learning who God is. Having to work past three friends. By the way, if you study those three friends' names out in their backgrounds, those three friends represented three different religious thoughts about who God was. Eliphaz, being the one I'm going to deal with today, Eliphaz would represent what we would know as Judaism or the law, because Eliphaz means in Hebrew tongue, God is gold, or El is gold, or God is pure. And God only wants the pure. Isn't that funny? Because everything that God built in the temple was hammered gold laid over wood. That's another story. Verse 8. And the Lord said to Satan, if you consider my servant Job, there's none like him in the earth, a perfect and upright man, one that fears God and hates or eschews evil. And Satan answered the Lord and said, does Job fear God for nothing? Have you not built a hedge about him and his house and everything that he has? Have you not blessed the work of his hands and the substance has increased in the land? Somebody say, thank you, Jesus. You have to understand, this is God's will for you. He has thoughts of peace toward you and that you should prosper. That's what God wants for his children. But what was Job dealing with? Fear. Job was dealing with fear. 11. Satan looks at God and tries to tell him what to do. But put forth your hand now and touch all that he has. He'll curse you to your face. Well, number one, God's not going to put forth his hand and hurt anything that belongs to any of his children. But watch. This is where we get the definition of the word wrath in Hebrew. It's where God has been holding the enemy back when you've been asking for the enemy to step in. Preacher, I don't ask for the enemy to step in. Sure you do. Anytime you speak in doubt, speak in unbelief, anytime that you say God can't. You see, God's love for you is to give you the desires of your heart. And he holds back until you push the tide so far that the only way you're going to learn the nature of God is for God to let it go a little bit and then put it back. He's going to let it go a little bit and put it back. It's kind of like you as a parent. You know, I've shared the story many times of me and the bobby pin, where I grew up in a farmhouse and nice electrical outlets, and my mom wore bobby pins, and I was always trying to stick something in the electrical outlet because they were always spanking me when I got near it. I knew they were hiding some great thrill from me. There was something there, or they wouldn't be keeping me from it. And I got spanking after spanking. I mean, I tried to stick pocket knives, butter knives, you name it. I tried to shove it in there. And one day I found a bobby pin, and we were sitting watching TV that night, the Lawrence Welk show. Anybody remember those tiny bubbles? Okay, anyway, watching the Lawrence Welk show, and I come across the floor with a bobby pin. And Daddy saw me, and he leaned up to stop me, and he leaned back. And I snuck over to that outlet, and I said, here we go. When I came to, I was on the other side of the living room, hand charred, lit up, and Daddy there picking me up. He said, I tried to tell you, but you wouldn't believe me, so you had to learn it the hard way. You see, a lot of this that Job's learning, he's having to learn the hard way. Because his trust is not in God yet. So you know the rest of the story. Look, but let's go to verse 12. The Lord said to Satan, behold, all that he has is in your power. Only upon himself don't put forth your hand. So Satan went from the presence of the Lord. So Satan then manipulated nature, not God. Satan sent lightning. Satan sent wind. They blamed God for it. Read the story. Look at verse 16. While he was yet speaking, there came also another and said, the fire of God has fallen from heaven, like God's killing people. When Satan's the one that steals, kills, destroys. They didn't know who God was. Okay? Then a great wind came, verse 19. Verse 20, 21, 22. Job arose, tore his clothing, shaved his head, fell down and worshiped. And he said, naked I came, naked I'll go. But he doesn't know God. So he says, the Lord gives and the Lord takes away. But he doesn't know the Lord. 22, in all this Job didn't sin, nor did he charge God foolishly. Chapter 2, most people forget this. And again, same story repeats again. Satan appears back in heaven for the second time. And God says, have you considered Job yet again? In other words, Job was still fearful. Have you considered him again? Verse 4, Satan answered and said, skin for skin. Yes, all that a man has he will give for his life. And again he tries to command God. Put your hand forth and touch his bone and flesh and he'll curse you to your face. God's not going to reach down and give you cancer. I love it when people say that. Well, I've got cancer. God knows what he's doing. God didn't give you cancer. He's a good father. What would you give your kids cancer to show them you love them? Why do you think God would? God didn't do that to you. Don't blame him for it. Amen? So the Lord said to Satan, behold, he's in your hand, but save his life. So Satan went forth and smote Job with sore boils from the sole of his feet to his crown. I want you to grab this misunderstanding of God. We keep thinking God's doing this stuff. God is trying to teach Job who he is. Because Job hasn't reached his potential. Oh, but Job has. Now watch now. Then Job's three buddies show up. Look at verse, and Job falls apart. When his three friends show up, Job falls apart. These three religions come sit with him and cry for 7 days. And Job, in verse 25 of chapter 3, says this. 3:25, read it with me. For the thing which I greatly feared has come upon me. And that which I was afraid of is come unto me. I was not in safety, neither had I, neither was I quiet, yet trouble came. Now I want you to grab this. Because of our misunderstanding God, because of our belief that God is angry, there's a process we will go through to learn just how good God is. And just how wrong we've been about God. When you read the discourse of Job's conversation, Job's three religious friends sit with him and they tell him, there's hidden sin in your life. You're not acting right. You're not good enough. You're not prayed hard enough. You've not given enough. It's your wife's fault. They've given Job every reason. They've even blamed God himself for everything going on. Nobody one time blamed the devil. Everybody wanted to blame God. Because you know you can't trust God. He's liable to bless you one day and let you win the lottery and then give you cancer the next. But who wants to serve a God like that? God doesn't do these things. That's not God. But the one thing that God does want his children to do is trust him. Now, how can he have plans for me and they be good plans, and then he'd do all this bad stuff to me? God didn't do this bad stuff to Job. Job embraced fear. And fear has fruit. Job embraced fear. Job had no reason to fear. Who had built a hedge of protection around him? And his family. And his family wasn't even living right, and God still had a hedge of protection around them. Is anybody getting this? Where had God failed? He had not. Why was Job afraid? He didn't get it. So let me take you to chapter 42. Let's go to this, Paul Harvey would say, the rest of the story. Chapter 42, going to read it from the NLT because it just reads better. 42, starting at 1. Then Job replied to the Lord. This is after God sat him down. Now Job's mad now, and Job isn't holding his tongue back. Job is giving God his discourse. God, I've done this for you, and I've done this for you, and I've done this, and God, I've been. You know, hang on a second. Let me show you something. Let me show you something else about Job that you might not have known. Go to chapter 4. Let me show you something about Job you may have never picked up on. Because Eliphaz gives us a little hint about Job's pride. 4:1, then Eliphaz the Temanite, which means he was the son of Esau, okay, answered and said, if we assay to commune with thee, will you be grieved? But who can withhold himself from speaking? Other words, you talk to us all the time when we were going through hard stuff. Now we're fixing to talk to you. Verse 3, behold, you've instructed many, and you've strengthened weak hands. Your words have upheld him that was falling, and you've strengthened those with feeble knees. But now it's come upon you, and you're fainting? It's touched you, and you're troubled? Somebody say, uh-oh. Time to practice what you preach. Look what Eliphaz says. Is this not your fear? Is this not your confidence, your hope, and the uprightness of your ways? Job, isn't what you've said is that we can trust God in all these things? Then Job, why are you falling apart? You told us not to fall apart. How many of you have discovered that when you get up and harp on somebody and preach on something, that you face the very thing you open your mouth about shortly thereafter? Anybody discover that other than me? See, honey, I can't wait till God gives me a sermon series on how to handle big wads of money. Because then I'll know how to face it when it's over. But so far it hadn't happened. But I'm working on it. Somebody say hallelujah. Then Job replied, 42:1. Job replied to the Lord, I know, this is Job learning. He's now learning who God is. I know you can do anything, and no one can stop you. You ask God, you ask me, who is this that questions my wisdom with such ignorance? What did Job have to admit? Your ways are not my ways. In other words, the spirit of stupid has been all over me, God. It is I, he says. Look, it is I. Say those three words. It is I. Isn't it liberating to finally admit that you're dumb? Some of you have a hard time with that, don't you? See, I know I'm dumb. My daddy called me dumb from the time I was 5 years old till last weekend. And because I'm so dumb, I just depend on God. And I found him to be an ever-present help in time of trouble. I don't have to know how it works. I don't have to know where the hurricane is, how fast it is, how high the water's rising. I don't have to know those things. My trust is in the Lord. Pastor, you say stick your head in the sand? No, I'm saying don't fall apart. So you lose a house. So you lose a car or two. Or so like Job, you lose it all. Job didn't lose just a couple of things. Job lost everything except a nagging wife. I didn't interpret anything. I just read it and told you what it is. It is I. And look what he says. And I was talking about things that I knew nothing about. So when I tell you, reading the first part of Job, chapters 42 backwards, everything from 42 backwards is, uh-oh, I don't know what I'm talking about. But yet people will quote chapter 1 through chapter 42 as the word of God. No, I just told you, it's words of ignorance. Until God begins to speak in the book of Job. Until God says, wait a minute, boy. Sit down. Gird yourself up like a man. You've talked about me. Now I'm going to tell you who I am. You've accused me of every bad thing on the planet. Now I'm going to tell you, I'm the one holding it all together. From that point on, it's good word. From that point back, it's all the spirit of stupid. He says, I was the one talking about things I knew nothing about, things far too wonderful for me. You said, God, listen, and I will speak. I have some questions for you, and you must answer them. So, Lord, here's my confession. Read it with me. Verse 5. I had only heard about you before, but now I have seen you with my own eyes. I take back everything I said. And I sit down in dust and ashes to show my repentance. Listen to me, sweetheart. He's a good, good father. In verse 7, God speaks to Eliphaz. He speaks to the other two friends. And he says, y'all better repent too. And they did. And offering was given for them. And it goes on. And God blessed Job back with twice that he had before that he thought he lost. So let me close you with this as the music plays softly. Romans chapter 8, 31 through 37. What shall we say then about such wonderful things as these? If God is for us, who can ever be against us? Since he did not spare even his own son, but gave him up for us all, won't he also give us everything else? Who dares accuse us, whom God has chosen for his own? No one. For God himself has given us right standing with himself. Who will then condemn us? No one. For Christ died for us and was raised to life for us. And he's sitting in the place of honor at God's right hand, pleading for us. Can anything ever separate us from God's love? Does it mean he no longer loves us if we have trouble or calamity or are persecuted or hungry or destitute or in danger or threatened with death? As the scriptures say, for your sake we are killed every day. We are being slaughtered like sheep. The answer for 37 is no. Despite all these things, overwhelming victory is ours through Christ who loved us. Can somebody say yes and amen? Woo! Stand with me if you would. Repeat these words. In God, I trust. Say it again. In God, I trust. Say it again. In God, I trust. He cannot fail. He will not fail. Even when we fall, He will pick us up. So don't worry. Don't be troubled. Live in peace. Amen? Amen. Pastor Brandon, do we have a closing remark from Brandon? I don't guess we do. So let me close it. Please don't forget Pastor Appreciation Sunday, they told me. That's kind of embarrassing for me to have to announce Pastor Appreciation Sunday. Anyway, we're going to be at, it's only one.
Thank you for joining us today at Journey Church. Join us on our journey. Contact us on the web at www.journeychurchmb.com. For Pastor Tom Wallace and all the congregation at Journey Church, may God richly bless you today.